20th Sunday after Pentecost. Welcome to worship. Reformation Sunday is on October 27th, and to add a little pizzazz to commemorate this special day of the Lutheran Church, you're encouraged to wear your Lutheran sweatshirt or something red, where it reminds us of the fire of the Spirit and Reformation. Reformation snacks will be served in the narthex after the worship service, so let's celebrate. Are there any announcements from the congregation?
Yep.
Double deal.
If you have not turned in your liturgy survey, I need that ASAP.
Okay, what we're going to do is, after the worship service, a couple of guys are going to help me get the grills going. I won't mention any names, Steve and Randy, but anyway, they're going to help me, and we're going to get the stuff cooking. But then we're going to have a little concert here, so just stay right here. We'll have a little bluegrass concert, and then when the food is ready, I'll come and tell you. Okay? Any other announcements?
Hey, Cal. Cal.
What?
Were you going to introduce?
There is one other person I want to introduce, and that is a young man who's going to be our new organist. He's going to start next Sunday at Our Blessed Savior. Please stand up. His name is... His name is Perry Kesset Tunajaja. He goes by Perry. So that will help out. Perry, thank you.
I don't know if this is an announcement or not, but will you kind of, you know what, who was it used to say, and now is the rest of the story, remember that? Okay, well, last year we were here on October 1st, and Maddie, which is Michael's wife, she was about ready to have a baby, and on the way home, Michael called us and told us that she had the baby on October 1st, and there she is here today. Yeah, that's why you weren't here last year, that's right. He had a good excuse for not being here last year. And her name is Alora. What does that mean, Michael?
God is my light in Hebrew.
Our first song is a gathering song. It's called What a Friend We Have in Jesus. It should be the first one on your song sheet. Thank you.
sing to God in prayer.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Sovereign God, you have created us to live in loving community with one another. Form us for life that is faithful and steadfast, and teach us to trust like little children, that we may reflect the image of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. First reading is from Genesis chapter 2.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
As Pastor said, the first reading is from Genesis chapter 2, 18 through 24. The Lord God said, "It is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him a helper as his partner." So out of the ground, the Lord God formed every animal of the field and every bird of the air, and brought them to the man to see what he would call them. And whatever the man called every living creature, that was its name. The man gave names to all the cattle, and to the birds of the air, and to every animal of the field. But for the man, there was not found a helper as his partner. So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and he slept. Then he took up one of his ribs, and closed up his place of flesh. And the rib that the Lord God had taken from the man, he made into a woman, and brought her to the man. Then the man said, This at last is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. This one shall be called woman, for out of man this one was taken. Therefore a man leaves his father and his mother and clings to his wife, and they become one flesh." Please read the Psalms responsibly. Psalm 8, chapter 8 and 5. O Lord, our Lord, Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth.
You whose glory is chanted above the heavens, out of the mouths of infants and children, you have set up a fortress against your enemies, to silence the foe and avenger.
When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars you have set in their courses,
what are mere mortals that you should be mindful of them, human beings that you should care for them?
Yet you have made them little less than divine. With glory and honor, you crown them.
You have made them rule the works of your hands, and have put all things under their feet.
All flocks and cattle, even the wild beasts of the field.
The birds of the air, the fish of the sea, and whatever passes along the paths of the sea.
O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. The second reading is from Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 through 4, and chapter 2, verses 5 through 12. Long ago, God spoke to our ancestors in many ways and various ways by the prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by a Son, whom he appointed heir of all things. Through him, he also created the worlds. He is the reflection of God's glory and the exact imprint of God's very being. And he sustains all things by his powerful word. When he had made purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the Majestic on high. Having become as much superior to angels as the name he has inherited is more excellent than theirs. Now God did not subject the coming world, about which we were speaking, to angels. But someone has testified somewhere, "What are human beings that you are mindful of them, or mortals that you care for them? You have made them for little while lower than the angels. You have crowned them with glory and honor, subjecting all things under their feet. Now in subjecting all things to them, God left nothing outside their control. As it is, we do not yet see everything in subjection to them, but we do see Jesus, for a little while was made lower than the angels, now crowned with glory and honor because of the suffering of death, so that by the grace of God he might taste death for everyone. It was fitting that God, for whom and through whom all things exist, in bringing many children to glory, should make the pioneer of their salvation perfect through sufferings. For the one who sanctifies and those who are sanctified all have one Father. For this reason, Jesus is not ashamed to call them brothers and sisters, saying, I will proclaim your name to my brothers and sisters. In the midst of the congregation, I will praise you. Here ends the readings.
The Holy Gospel is written in Mark chapter 10, beginning with verse 2. Some Pharisees came, and to test Jesus, they asked, is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife? He answered them, what did Moses command you? They said, Moses allowed a man to write a certificate of dismissal and to divorce her. But Jesus said to them, because of your hardness of heart, he wrote this commandment for you. But from the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate. Then in the house, the disciples asked him again about this matter. He said to them, whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery against her. And if she divorces her husband and marries another, she commits adultery. People were bringing little children to him in order that he might touch them. And the disciples spoke sternly to them. But when Jesus saw this, he was indignant and said to them, let the little children come to me. Do not stop them, for it is to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it. And he took them up in his arms, laid his hands on them, and blessed them. Do we have any children today? Guess not. Okay. We'll skip that then. We have a three-year lectionary, and that means that there are lessons picked, four lessons for every week, and they try to cover all the main events in the church year. And they roll around every 3 years. And some of these, not everybody likes to preach on. And I think the three-year lectionary disciplines people to say, here's something, if you don't want to preach on it, go ahead and do it anyway. And today's gospel lesson is one of those. It rolls around, and it showed up again here today, and it's about a topic that's not very fun, and that is divorce. Lest you think the scriptures are not relevant to today, half of all marriages in America end in divorce. And so we have to look at this issue and say, what is Jesus really trying to get at here? And the way this started was not because Jesus set out to have a sermon about divorce, although this is the most lengthy discussion of the topic that there is in Scripture. But what happened was the religious leaders, the scribes and the Pharisees, came to Jesus and they had a plan to try to trap him with something, as they were always trying to do, because he didn't follow all their traditions. They were very threatened by Jesus. So they were going to trap him, and they thought that the topic that would do this was divorce. So they came up to Jesus and said, what do you think, teacher, what do you think about divorce? And he says, well, what did Moses command about divorce? And, oh, well, Moses said that a man could divorce a wife, write her a certificate of divorce. And Jesus then said, well, yeah, he did that because of the hardness of your hearts. But let's not talk about what Moses allowed. Let's talk about what God intended. Let's go all the way back to creation. What did God intend for men and women? And what he intended was to be in good relationship, to be helpers to one another, to love one another, to speak well of one another, and be happy together. That's what God intended. Well, that doesn't always happen. And then Jesus said, he makes it even harder. He says, and by the way, whoever divorces a woman and marries another is committing adultery. We got a little adultery going on here. Well, thank you for that. But then what he's really doing is Jesus is trying to stand up for the disadvantaged in his culture. Because here was the story on men and women at Jesus' time. It was a man's world. And you notice that a text says, can a man divorce his wife? You know what it doesn't say? Can a woman divorce her husband? Because she couldn't. There was no recourse to that for a woman. And the other thing about it was, divorce was terrible. If you think it's tough now, which it is, it's hard on everybody, it's hard on people, it's hard on the kids, it's hard on families, it's hard on the church, the friends, it's hard on everybody. You know, people used to have more kids 100 years ago. Now with blended families, kids have more parents. So, it was a difficult thing. It's even worse because women couldn't have businesses to support themselves. The only thing that a woman had if she was divorced was the bride price, which is a little amount of money set aside when she was married. And after that was gone, she had two options. One, find some relative who would take her in with pity, or two, become a prostitute. That was about it. So believe me, women really towed the line in that culture because they didn't want to end up destitute or prostitute or rootitude or any of those other tunes. That was not good. And so Jesus, what he is doing here really is he is standing in the tragic gap between those in power and those who don't have power. In that culture, women, they did not have power. The advantaged and the disadvantaged. And you notice that he then takes the other group at the end of the lesson and he says, what about children? Because they were the other disadvantaged group at Jesus' time. Children had really no standing at all. 30% died at birth, another 30% were gone before 6 years of age. They didn't really count on kids much till they got old enough that they might survive. And so you had women and children, and Jesus talks about both of those in this text to say, we should be standing with them. Now, many years ago, in my first parish in North Dakota, this text showed up, and I preached on it, and afterwards a woman came up to me, and she said, all right, Pastor Kal, now don't be wishy-washy. Tell me, yes or no, is divorce a sin? And I said, well, I could talk big and bold then, because I hadn't been divorced yet. I said, if it is true, and it is, that sin means damaged or broken relationship, that's a definition for sin, then of course divorce is a sin. But the sin didn't happen when you went in front of the judge and he signed the paper. The sin happened when you stopped supporting one another. The sin happened when you started using derogatory terms for your partner. The sin happened when you started looking to other people other than your spouse to make you feel more attractive. The sin happened when you started jabbing at your partner. The sin happened when you were making snide comments and not being helpful at all. That's when the sin happened. Not the day before when you went to the judge. It was already going on a long. That's just the proof that sin was happening for a long time. And so it happens to be that there may be people who are still married who are actually sinning more than if they get divorced because they're being mean and spiteful and resentful, hostile, angry, jabbing, hurting one another, being lonely. They may be sinning more. I can think of a couple examples where it would be better to get divorced. When I used to work in chemical dependency, one of the things that we always knew was that it takes a lot to pry somebody into treatment to get help. And one of the things that would do it was if their spouse said, you don't get help, I'm leaving you. Right, Bruce? That's one of the big crowbars to get people into treatment. And it may well be the most loving thing to do because you can save somebody's life by that, leaving them and getting help. And besides that, you're not doing much for your relationship to yourself being bulldozed in codependency with that. The other thing that I think of is if you're in a relationship that is abusive, divorce is better, is less sinful than staying in an abusive relationship. If you're getting physically abused, verbally, emotionally abused, sexually abused, get out. You're not helping them to let them keep on being a bully. And if your relationship with yourself means anything, you're not helping you. So there are times when divorce may be, in fact, better than staying with somebody. Is it a sin? Yes. But so is all the other stuff that goes in front of that. And so we look at this text by Jesus and say, what is he really getting at? What he's getting at is to say, you know, you're not going to be able to probably do this anyway. We look at the Ten Commandments and I think to myself, wow, I have a tough time trying to keep them the way they are. And then give Jesus' ramped up version of the commandments where he says, oh, and by the way, later on in this gospel, he says, by the way, if any of you men even look at another woman with lust in your heart, you've already committed adultery. Now, I want a show of hands, how many men in here have never looked at another woman with lust in their heart? I want to find out who the big fat liars are in here. That would be me. I did once, Deborah. And then the next one he says, and by the way, let's take the commandment before that. Anybody, you shall not kill. Well, anybody who even holds anger against his brother has already broken the fifth commandment. Jesus takes these commandments and ramps them up. And at the end, we have to say, well, who can keep that? And the answer is nobody. And that is what drives us to the foot of the cross to say, Lord God, be merciful to me. I try in my relationships, but I don't always do very good. Lord, have mercy on me. And the best part of this is that God never divorces us. We are faithless, and he is faithful. We don't rely on him, stray from him, and he always is there for us. And that is what gives us hope. Jesus wanted us to have the best in relationships. In relationship to God, in relationship to other people, in relationship to ourselves. And he makes sure that he is there with us to send his Spirit to give us the strength to do that as best we can, and then rely on God's grace. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen.
Yes.
The next song that we're going to do is The Old Rugged Cross. It should be the next sheet in your handout there. On a hill far away, so I'm The next song is Leaning on the Everlasting Arms.
Ready?
Yeah, I guess I can
do it. Do it. A little bit slower.
Saying the creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Gracious God, have mercy on us. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone. Uphold us by your Spirit, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Almighty and merciful Lord grant us pardon, forgiveness, and remission of all our sins.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Peace.
Peace. Peace.
Peace.
Peace.
We'll now receive the offering. Tender nurture and care. Help us to delight in your will and walk in your ways through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray with confidence in the words our Savior gave us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Our sending song will be Just a Closer Walk with Thee.
I am weak, but thou art strong. Jesus, keep me from wrong.
Go in peace. Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.